Okay, you can hear me, right?
Oh yeah, I can hear you.
Let's get going.
I can see you.
You want to do the record?
Nope. Why?
So important to you. Clock is ticking.
Why is the clock ticking tonight,
Joe? Because I got stuff to do.
What do you got to do?
I've got some studying to do.
I can't record this week. I have to study. What?
Yeah, sorry that you're not sensitive to that.
I was very sensitive.
Are you serious? You don't want to record tonight?
Yeah.
Fuck.
Because of studying. Yeah. I never heard of such a thing.
Yeah, sorry.
Are you getting your doctorate? What's going on? All right, so what? You're going to be pissy pants?
I'm still upset.
Over what? That makes no sense.
Really?
I told you.
What if I had said, no, I'm not recording tonight?
Then I would have went forward. Forged on ahead.
Why don't you just do that?
Well, because then you said, can you go at 10:30? So, yeah, obviously.
Making you happy.
I'd do anything for Joe.
No, I'm Joe's doing you a favor.
You're not doing me a favor. You're doing the listenership a favor.
They're probably upset at you like I am.
Especially after the weekend you had. You have nothing to be pissy pants about.
Woo!
I'm glad I'm off all week, folks. Let me tell you.
I'm glad you're off too.
This is the episode people have been waiting all year for. The post-Barrie Game Exchange wrap-up episode of STCPod, Start to Continue podcast, because we were live and in person at the Barrie Game Exchange along with a bunch of other cartridge clubbers, a whole row of cartridge club contributors, had a whole bunch of tables there selling their wares and saying hello and passing out business cards and standing in front of cartridge club paraphernalia so everyone could see us and get on board the Red Wave cartridge club. What can I say? This was a lot of lead up going into this. Cartridge club was entering into a new wave of partnership with the Barrie Game Exchange, hoping to get early on inside with this important event, which is only getting bigger every year. So it's very important for us and the cartridge club and everyone to have a great showing at this one. And I think we did. And we had a lot of lead up, a lot of talk getting into it. A lot of push on the socials, a lot of advertising. And so there was a lot of anticipation going into this show. I had a big week before that because I had a concert to go to. I bought tickets along with Kevin and Sarah to go see the Raconteur-ing, and that would have been on the Thursday last week. So I had to have a whole whack of time off. I had to get that Thursday off. We were off for the weekend for the game exchange, and might as well continue taking time off. So I took this week off as well to recover. But I'm on a side note, I am having family come up for a visit this week. So everything worked out. Thursday night. Met Kevin and Sarah up on the highway. Drove down all the way into Toronto. Found some really good parking. Green Pea parking. So it was nice and cheap. Green Pea is like the municipal parking lots, so they keep the price capped. And so we got to, I think it was only $7 to park there. So that's pretty good for Toronto. Within walking distance of the Sony Center. It's now called the Meridian Place or some bullshit. Which is like a me and you saw, did we see Marc Maron there? That was the Sony Center, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was.
I think I saw Bob there once. I really like that venue. What do you think? Around 2,000 seats, 1,500, something like that.
Yeah, a decent size for it still makes it a rather intimate experience as well, right? So, sound is good.
Yeah, it's got your theatrical seating, you know, going up, but it also has a mezzanine like balcony area looking down over the stage. And I was lucky enough to get tickets up there, second row from the front. So as long as you didn't get Monster Andre the Giant's in front of you, you get a beautiful view overlooking the stage, and you're getting the full on power of the sound system from there. And so I was looking forward to that. We got there a little bit early, so we thought we'd grab a drink across the street. There was a Franz there. Do you know what a Franz is? Franz Deli?
Nope.
The Torontoites do. Actually, it franchised out a bit. Like, there was a Franz here in Barrie for a little while, but it closed. But there's a Franz on Queen Street at Yonge. That's the famous one where you'd go after your Massey Hall concerts and it'd be open in the middle of the night, and you know, you'd run into Gordon Lightfoot there, kind of thing. Be part of the scene. This is a more touristy trap one because it's right there on Front and Church. It's a couple over from Yonge Street. And so we went in there for a drink, and there was this table beside. Anyway, I probably shouldn't even bother telling you the story because, you know, the Fandango is probably going to talk about it. So I'll just burn through it quickly. We noticed the table beside us. People kept coming up to this table and going, like, getting fist bumps from the guy and saying, yeah, I really like your stuff. You're really good, man. It's exciting. We're like, what? Who are you? Is that the opening act beside us? Because there was an opening act to our concert that we didn't really know. I don't know. And then finally, I think it dawned on Kevin that, dude, that's Mike Smith. And I mean, he's right beside us. He's like elbows over from us. And I said, what? Kevin's like, that's Mike Smith. And I said, what? And both Kevin and Sarah's like, it's Mike Smith. I said, what? It's Cunning Lingus? I don't know what you're saying because it's loud in there. And then I kind of pieced it together. I look over. Oh, of course it is. It's Mike Smith. The Bubbles from Trailer Park Boys was sitting there. And I was more taken aback by his shirt. He had a fabulous shirt on. Just a fabulous print on his shirt. And he had trendy glasses on. And he was there with a couple ladies. And they left to go get their seats. And he was getting ghosted by the staff waiting for his bill. So he's just sitting there, waiting for his bill, looking around. More people came up to him, gave him business cards and stuff. And so I had a chance right then to engage him, only very slightly. And he's pretty friendly. I got to talk to Bubs for a minute. And so then we went to the show after that. The opening act was this surf slash grunge slash bluesy. This girl, she had a band behind her, and it was fine. It was interesting fusion of different styles. I was taken aback by the lack of guitar breaks in it. It was just like song, 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 and move on to the next song, 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 song. I really wanted them to unleash the guitar. So that really didn't happen. The last part of her set was the strongest, I thought. Had some good songs. But fire that guitarist and get a real one in there who can break away for some good stuff. Have you ever heard of her? Olivia Jean. She's part of Third Man Records crew. She's got like a, you know, that look, that 50s kind of look with the, you know, but with the heavy mascara and stuff. No, Joe saying no.
Nope.
Anyways, she was done. An hour? I think she did an hour. Then, and right on time. Like, the show was supposed to start at 8. They started right at freaking 8. And then she did an hour. They broke down her stage apparatus, the drums, all that, and got ready for the Raconteurs to come out. Raconteurs are, of course, a big band that Jack White is a part of, not necessarily front man, but, you know, one of the people in the Raconteurs. And when they came out, it was incendiary, man. It was so loud and so powerful. Their music is more, you listen to their records, it's more, I don't want to say mellow, but very, I don't know. It can be Americana. It can be warm, very rhythmic. I don't know how to describe it, but the live was just like an atomic bomb went off. You could hear the drums like pounding in your chest. As you can imagine, right, that closed theater, super loud rock band. And they went at it. It was big stuff. And actually, song number two and song number four, Jack White's solos, raised the hair on my arms. Goosebumps. Goosebumps. That doesn't happen very often at a concert. But the way they built it up. And the fourth song, he was like doing a ditty at the keyboards, you know, and did a bit of a soloing at the keyboard as the song is building into this crescendo. And as he's building it on the keyboards, his keyboard player came over and took over for him. And he ran over to the guitars as the song is continuing to build, strapped on a guitar. And just as it was to climax, you could tell his solo was going to just make the walls bleed. And sure enough, it did. And as opening smack of the strings, my goosebumps just went up like that. It was well done. Theatrical, even though there wasn't a huge, huge stage production going on. They had some like flashy lights that moved around, but other than that, it was all about the music. Good old fashioned rock music. It was good times. It was good times. And since we were up in the mezzanine area with only one row in front of us, we got to sit down the entire show, which I like that. I like being able to relax and enjoy the show. And so that was good. It's good times. I recommend you go see a rock act at the Meridian Place or whatever the hell it's called. The Sony Center. I think it took 2 days for my ears to stop ringing. It was a good time. And no drama from the people beside me. We had two people beside me and then the end of the row. They were like, young hipster types, skinny. They were well in their seat, so I had lots of room to spread out. And they, they daintily put their earplugs in before the show started. So they, got ready for the show. And then beside Kevin, this big, burly, two-fisted beer guy sat down. So I had a good chuckle over that, because usually the big two-fisted beer dudes are sitting beside me, but Kevin got it this time. He got that guy's stomach right in, I think he put it right on Kevin's lap for a little bit. So that was fun times to watch that.
How long was the show?
They probably went for 2 hours, I'd say. Yeah, good 2 hours, very strong. They had a break, then came back. I don't know if they call it encores anymore. They just had a break. Then they came back and lit the house up with some tracks that you would more recognize from their first album. It's good good typing. Are you studying right now?
Yep.
Yep, that's good.
I was letting you tell your story. Glad you had a good time at the show. How much were tickets?
Tickets weren't bad. Like, it's a pretty big name band, and there's only so many seats at that place. Our tickets were just over $100 after service fees. Of course, they went. There was a huge area before the stage that was general admission. If I recall, those were probably $300 or $400. But it was general admission, like I'm not used to seeing. Like, at concerts, you usually always see that the gate, and then the security guys, and then the stage. It wasn't like that. It was like music documentaries from the 60s where you see that general admission is right up at the stage where they can rest their arms on the stage. That's how it was. There was no security between the audience and the stage. And you could tell the performers really get off on that because the crowd is like right there. So that was kind of cool to see that coming back. Also, to note that this was a phone-free venue. So you get there and you had your phone put in a sealed pouch, and then you're given the pouch to carry around. So it was also nice not to have any kind of phone distraction going on. The only kind of distraction was me looking at some of the nuts in the crowd who were taking it way too seriously. But God love them. They love the music.
And that was it? You guys just drove back after the show? Did you guys have like a nightcap or anything like that?
No time for that. We all had a bit of a drive, but I think Kevin and Sarah both worked the next day. So they had like 5 o'clock alarm calls coming. So I don't know. I'm sure you'll hear more from the Fandango. I tried to breeze through this as quick as possible.
No, I appreciate it.
Oh, God.
That's good. Well, I'm glad you asked your friend to go see a concert with you.
Are you insinuating I didn't ask you? Because we know that's not true.
I don't remember you asking me, but you may have, you may not have. I may not have been listening.
I think you would have actually liked this one.
I probably would have. I've never seen them in concert, though I honestly haven't really listened to much of their music. Probably aside from what you've played for me.
No, what have they got? Like 2-3 albums in 13 years? So,
yeah, so.
There's not a lot of their music out there. Just.
Did they do any covers?
There was a medley where Shaken All Over was in there in the midst. You know, like, I forget who the original artist is, but I know it from The Who Live at Leeds, where they do Shaken All Over. Shaking all over. What?
So that'd be boring.
No, that was not boring.
I don't like that song.
It was part of a medley. So there might have been other covers in there that I missed, but.
Well, like you, I've been downtown the last 2 days. And this is the first time I've actually traveled downtown Toronto in, I don't know, probably last time I went was with you. So it's been years. And I've actually taken the GO train these last 2 days. And that was an experience. When was the last time you took a GO train down?
I never, ever do. Yeah, never.
Neither do I. Except I was told I should take it. It'd be easier. So up at and 5, I catch the whatever it is, 6:15 train or something like that. The express train in Whippy. 6:09 train. And then I'm downtown by 6:55. And then I got to walk 20 minutes north up to Bay Street. Atrium on Bay. I'm sure you know where that is.
Sure.
That's a delightful walk. As I step over homeless people sleeping on the streets.
I don't, 20 minute walk might be a bit much, isn't it?
It's a solid 15 mm-hmm. to 20. Yeah, I never take the GO train and I never like going downtown. And this has been great. I love seeing, who are these people that wear the dress pants that are so short that I can see their leg skin as they're walking? Is that a new trend? You know those people?
Yeah. They're cool people. They're in trend.
They look like they're wearing pants that my son wears. Because I can see all their socks and I can see leg skin. So how short is this when they actually sit down? These hipsters, man. Look like idiots.
What were you wearing?
Just jeans and a golf shirt.
Oh, fancy.
Not fancy.
You're going to Bay and rich people.
Yeah. So. I'm not doing a business transaction.
What are you doing?
I'm in a classroom.
Doing what?
Listening. Learning.
Learning. Is it really worthwhile stuff?
Just because, listen, can you be fucking positive?
I'm not positive.
Yeah. You're supposed to say, oh, good for you, man. Glad you're enjoying the course or something like that. Make it up.
Yep.
Instead of being like Peter.
I'm glad you're getting ahead of me in your career. I'm glad you have such a close relationship with our boss that you could set that up and get ahead.
You can do it too.
Nope. You got to get the tap from above. And you can only do that if you know the correct Italian word for welcome to the club.
Is that what it is?
I think so. Mm-hmm. Something like that.
So anyway, that's been my delightful experience. $22 round trip GO train.
Oh, why do they have to do it downtown? Like, it, we're not talking a specific course that isn't given any, you know.
In Toronto, in the Toronto area, there's two downtown locations. One's on Dundas or something like that, and the other one's on Bay Street.
So why maybe like the second day? Or are you going back tomorrow, I assume?
Tomorrow's the last day.
So why are you going to bother with the GO? Try driving it.
I don't know. Gas, parking.
Your car, the gas ain't going to cost $22. Now, parking is different. But surely the place you're going might have some kind of validated parking.
I don't think it does. Not for this. Even the instructor parks like a block away, and I think he pays like $25. But his is covered. Anyway, it's been an experience. I don't miss not going downtown, because I did work down there for a period. Not as long as you. And I had my fill. Though some of the ladies were looking nice.
Oof.
That's one thing I appreciated. Even as the weather is starting to cool down. Some are looking nice and some are not looking nice. Some of the hefty bags are showing too much skin.
At lunch, would you at least go out and experience the downtown a little bit, or would you hide in the classroom?
Well, there's the atrium has the ground floor is all those restaurants, right? Food right. Court.
Yep.
So I went down there and had some healthy thing. I don't know. Healthy restaurants or whatever it is. And then today I actually brought food. So I just sat in the classroom and watched some YouTube. And then walked over to Best Buy, which is across the road, and checked out some headphones. He was looking at some over-the-ear headphones for the PS4 that have a mic built in.
Yeah, that would be nice.
And then I looked at some Beats for the gym, wireless ones. Did you know Apple bought Beats?
No, I did yeah, not.
Neither did I.
Why wouldn't you just get the semen dripping ones nope. from Apple?
These ones are actually, they fit into your ear, and then they've got the little plastic loop that goes around your ear to really hold them in place. For when you're running and doing physical stuff. Actually a brand new model that came out. So I was looking at that, and I was looking at headphones for the PS4. I got to do some research on the models. There's a straight up PS4 brand I could get. And then they had a bunch of Turtle Beach ones.
Well, just get yourself the PS4 camera. It's got a mic in it. No way you go. You're ready to go.
Yeah, but the mic can't be that good, man, if you're standing like 5 feet away, man.
It's actually not bad. I don't know if you've checked out any of my streams where I was using it. But if I'm
sitting and playing a game, I can have the headphones on, and these ones are like...
True. Yeah.
Where is it here?
Then what are you going to do for a camera?
Oh, I'd have to get the PS4 camera.
Yeah.
These ones are surround sound gaming headsets, 7.1 audio, virtual surround sound.
Because, I tuned in to a big fancy stream last night.
Turtle Beach Stealth 700 premium surround headset series.
I gotta be streaming. Come check out my stream. No mic, no camera, no typing. Wow.
There was typing.
As just
I chose not to type because I was playing the game.
Confused hey, gameplay. No, I'm watching.
I didn't ask you to I figured it out at the end. I didn't ask you to tune in.
Yeah, you did.
No, I think I said go away.
Big tweet. Come check
out. I didn't put it out. It's probably set up to do that then.
Well, you did. So why else would you stream if you didn't want anyone to check it out?
Because after it streams, then I can save it and actually have a file loaded up.
For what? The archives?
Yeah, the archives.
Well, it disappears after
like 30 days. No, if you... After you stream it, you can publish it and it stays up permanently.
No, it doesn't. It goes away.
No.
Yeah. Okay. Anyways, why would you want... Oh, I'm curious about my Shantae playthrough from 2019. Yeah. I'm going to dig that up.
Finally figured out what to do with that bloody elephant. Who knew it could fly off of platforms? Stupid thing. No help from you. No help from my partner.
Hey.
She's not a gamer.
At least I tuned in and I engaged, unlike you.
Your engagement was, what? Where's the camera? How come you're not talking? Because I'm playing the game.
Well, what's the point? That's the point.
Don't tune in.
I'm just curious. Why would I make a stream if I didn't want to talk to people?
I just told you why.
I just told you why that reason was stupid.
It's not stupid. You can do whatever you want. How about you be positive and not negative all the time? People get tired of your negativity.
People do not get tired of me calling out your crazies.
Of your negativity, yes, they get very tired of it. I've had people complain. Yeah. I don't know what's up with them.
I wonder what else you're going to start doing.
Whatever makes me happy.
Whatever. It's... Woo! All right.
Don't worry.
I'm looking forward to seeing
you. I'll hear about it at some point.
Anyways, I check you out. It'd be nice if you check mine out. And I know you have just ghost light. And so any kind of engagement helps, I think, in those streams. You got to at least say hello if you pop in. Don't just hide there and just to see what happens for a second. And then jump over to Musty's stream and go, hey, Musty, Joe here.
I never popped into your stream. Glad to see ya. Because I didn't know you were on. Okay. I told you that already, dude.
I know.
I saw Musty was on, so I went to him.
I'm just saying.
And then you raided, and then you got angry that as soon as you raided, I left.
No, that you did not engage on my stream. Anyways.
Because it didn't tell me you were on.
Anyways, no one cares. Yeah, because you're not subscribed to me. I don't
care that no one cares.
Yeah, you're not subscribed for one.
Yes, I am.
How about that for passive aggressive?
I am subscribed to you.
Well, then.
How could I see your thing if I'm not subscribed to you, maniac? Well,
apparently you didn't see it. Thank you. Case closed.
What are you talking? What an ass.
Well.
Yeah, I didn't see it because I was looking at Musty playing a game. How would I see it if he's full screen? How am I going to see that you're suddenly online? If I'm full screen with Musty. Oh, snap, I can't.
You're not full screen with Musty or you wouldn't be able to type. And if you're not full screen.
I'm not typing every second. I would type and then go full screen. Because then I can see whatever else people type just appears up. I'm not there to have a big, massive conversation. I just want to see him play. As Bill stares up into the ceiling, trying to think of something.
Oh, man. Well, anyways, we're jumping all around here. Jumping all around. Thursday had the concert. Friday.
Let's not take forever going through all this.
That was a day off, right? Friday was cleaning like mad because massive company was coming and I had to go to the airport. Yeah. To pick up Cartridge Club founder and VIP Sean Player One.
Being rude to Mark.
Co-founder. I think until Mark makes the trip to my house for a BBQ, he might be dead to me. So
he's still my friend.
I might have to go to extremes like that. Might have to.
Threatening?
Yeah, I guess. Let's all start threatening Mark. So I took a little trip to down to the airport, some YYZ, and picked up Sean. He was in the arrivals. And I don't know, the way they got the airport nowadays, it's pretty easy to get in and out of there. If someone wants asks you for a ride to or from the airport, they got it together. You just got a nice circle, things slow down, and you get right to the curb there, and they jump in, and away you go. Now, I remember, like, in the old days, it was white-knuckle drive. Well, that's what the
person's waiting for you.
Yeah, they got to be there. Well, there is, they do have, like, what do they call it? Like, cell phone lots, where you go park and wait for the message on your phone to come get them kind of thing. And that's free. Yeah, they figured it all out now. It's not too bad. So grabbed him, and we headed back up. I was using the Waze app for the first time. To get what? Back. The Waze app. Waze. The navigation application that you can put on your phone that everyone's using nowadays. Kevin told me I should be using it instead of Google. And I said, well, Google will tell you where there's a speed trap. He said, Waze does that. I said, well, Google will tell you if a new route comes up that's better. And he goes, Waze does that even better. So I started using that. And I threw that on as I left the airport to head back up, just so I wouldn't make a wrong turn somewhere. And it had me go north on the 427. And then, do you really go north? And if, anyways, okay, that's where I'm going. And it wanted me to go on the 407. It's like turn right on the 407, which is a toll road.
They're all set up to do that, man.
And it even said, this will cost you $5 and you're going there. And I'm like, no, I'm not. Because that's stupid at this time to go on the toll road. So I had to turn it off and just go with my wits, which that was one of my old routes in and out of the city anyway. So I knew, take that 427, you know, go to the Highway 27. Highway 27, that'll take you all the way to Barrie right there. That'll turn into Essa Road, actually. So I said to Sean, look, we can just take this all the way back. Be a nice ride through the country. Add maybe 10 minutes, but whatever. He was cool with that. By the way, the 400 has a lot of construcciones down there anyways, so why not? So we had a nice little ride back, grabbed some Tim Hortons in some town. I forget what it was called. That's all they had was a Tim Hortons. And of course the drive-through was lined up all the way around the building, up the parking lot and out into the road. And so we walked in and there was no one inside. This Ontario thing where people love to sit in their cars in the Tim Hortons drive-through. I don't get it. I don't get how people can do that. I just don't. It boggles my mind. Anyways, I'm off on a tangent. So grab Sean, drove back, you know, got kids from school. I had Sean with me, and I hadn't got my act together. I'm not good at planning, you know, company stuff. So I was a little behind on my grocery gathering and all that. So I took him around town, did some errands, you know, J-Rock knows all about my errands. And we did some groceries, went to Shoppers Drug Mart, you know, went to another grocery store, tried to find a fruit stand, you know, all kinds of fun stuff. But Sean loves that stuff. He loved it.
Oh, he doesn't?
Yeah, he loves it. Grabbed the kids from school. And then went back home, did a barbecue. So he got like a pre-barbecue situation, threw some steaks on there. Did up some potates on the Barbie as well. My own personal recipe. You know, all good stuff like that. Had dinner. I don't think we did anything that night. That night after dinner. Yeah, we were waiting for Sean's buddy, Jeff, also from Nova Scotia, to show up. And that is a guy you probably heard of on Twitter and on the socials as Self-Destructo.
Is that who that is?
Yeah.
Oh, shit. Yeah, so, I don't know who that guy was when we introduced ourselves to each other. So yeah, he goes, hey, I'm Jeff. Goes, I'm Joe, man. Nice to meet you. And that was it. Nobody explained anything. I don't know who the stranger is.
You could ask, or if you weren't so late. Anyways, we're getting ahead of the game.
I wasn't late.
Getting ahead of the game. So Jeff finally arrived.
The game up.
And never met him before, but still offered him accommodations on Sean's good word. And sure enough, he was a pretty terrific guy. We got along swimmingly. And he arrived. We had good times. We played some arcade games on the modded Xbox. Beat a couple games, just beat it. Turns out Polykill awarded the just beat it to just him and not me, even though they were two-player games. So that was upsetting. But, you know, you live through these things. And then Saturday, what do we do on Saturdays?
You asking me?
No, I'm asking the others.
You go with, yard sailing?
Yes, we went yard sailing. We saw some signs. Saw some signs on my end of town.
Signs on side.
And one sign said they start at 7. So I thought, well, we got to be there at 7. That's what you got to do. And they were all game for it. Jeff's an old-timey yard sailor, too. He's got lots of experience, so he was game for it. But, he, you know, these are plane guys. They got here by plane, so they don't have a lot of room to buy stuff, which is all the better for me. We had no competition in the shopping. So we jumped out and did some yard sailing. That was fun. Found nothing, of course.
That's fun.
Yeah. And there was just yard sales in my end of town, like my corner of town, actually. Drove all around the rest of town. No yard sales, just my little corner. So there was nothing to be found. But it was still good palling around, having lots of fun, talking about all kinds of things. Me and Jeff, you know, we were kind of slow in the morning. We were, you know, this is 6:30, 7 o'clock. We got to do this. Let's just go and do it. And move on from each one. Sean is like he just snorted a whole 10 lines of cocaine. Like he is fired out of a cannon first thing in the morning. He's all excited. He's jumping out of the car, screaming hello to the people as soon as he gets out. How you doing? What's going on? My name is Sean. I'm from Nova Scotia, Lower Sackville. How are you doing? Oh, yeah. What do you got this going on in your garage here? And meanwhile, I've already looked through everything and I'm back in the car waiting to go. And he's just bouncing around their house. Like, Sean, you're not a contestant in a game show. You don't have to explain to everybody what your occupation is and where you're from. Is just, there's no time. Let's move it along. He was having a good time though. He's jumping all around, having fun, big smile on his face. So whatever gets you going, it's much like another Nova Scotian that I've often stopped at yard sales with, where they just love the gift to gab. Must be a Nova Scotia thing. But Jeff was on my side. He's like, let's get going. Come on. So that was a fun part of that morning. And then, I don't know, not much going on until the big barbecue. We had people coming in throughout the day. You know, Kevin and Sarah arrived. James and his wife, Amanda, arrived. Eventually, Derek and his wife, Cynthia, arrived. They were the last ones because they kept sending me Twitter DMs if it was all right for them to show up yet, and I didn't get any of my DMs, so they kept staying away. Who else was there? Who am I? Can you help me out instead of doing math work, your homework here? Kevin, Sarah. Oh, Josh Creepleet. He also arrived from the Waterloo area. He was staying at the house too that night, Saturday night, so he brought an air mattress and all, you know, pillows, all kinds of things. Kevin, Sarah, James, Sean, Jeff, Josh, Derek. Dude, are you helping me? I don't want to forget anyone. Dude,
I wasn't there, so how can I help you?
You know who was there at the Bilby Q.
How would I know that? That doesn't make any logical sense.
Why can't you help someone?
Oh, I don't know who was there.
By the way,
Zach was there, and Bob showed up. Remember? Yeah.
By the way, James's wife Amanda brought this like nacho dip platter with like the nachos to go with it. You know where they spread the cream cheese on the bottom, and then there's some other ingredient, and then like a salsa, and then shredded cheese on top, and you take the chips and just trough your way in there. Man, that was good stuff. That was good stuff. And then when Derek and Cynthia arrives, she has these like pastry boxes in her arms, and she opens those puppies up, and she has baked these decadent chocolate cupcakes with chocolate frosting on them. And that was it for me and the no sugar clause for that weekend. There was no standing up to that. And oof, man, they were good. That was something else. She's quite the baker. For the show, she made these sugar cookies in the shape of Nintendo Switches, and she frosted them all up art style with Nintendo Switch paint on it, you know? It was fantastic. Her work was fantastic. She was going to sell them for like $2 each. And me and Sean were like, we'll buy them all for $2 each, and we'll sell them for $5. Sounds like a good deal. Like, they were that good. Anyways, I'm sure she sold out of those. I don't think I got one, by the way, but you know, I got the barbecue going. We had burgers and we had some sausages for the people who can't eat the burgers or prefer a sausage. J-Rock was there. Of course, J-Rock showed up. He was a surprise. He was a sleeper because no one knew he was coming. And sure enough, he was already in town when we reached out to him. So that was good. So I had purchased 24 burgers and a package of those massive Polish sausages and the buns to go with them. And the meat estimation was, I got to say, perfect on my behalf, because at the end of it, only two burgers remained and all sausages went like mad. Probably I should have just had a big sausage party, because sausages went over like gangbusters, as they should have. These Polish sausages from the deli are great. Working that Barbie, all these burgers flipping all over the place, flames are dancing, smoke all over the place. Still managed. I managed it okay. We got things done. Everyone got fed. I got to tell you, James, you know, James RetroPixel, what are you doing with your head? You're going back and forth, but it's very distracting as I try to have a conversation with you. Are you good? Are you done?
What did James do?
He ate like a madman, let me tell you. It was fun to watch, because James is not a big person by any means, and he ate all of us. I like to keep score on people's eating, right? Because that's fun. And, you know, I always ironically make fun of J-Rock for being a dainty eater, but that James, he could pound it back, let me tell you. And he kept circling that barbecue even after it was off. He was going through the troughs, or have a hot dog still. Yeah, grab that. He was a champion. So he won. In my judgment, James RetroPixel won the Bilbecue that Saturday. Edged out J-Rock for sure. And that was it. We hung out. We had another CC tradition of cigars came out that night. And you'll be proud to know that we're still on the brand you recommended to us, your redneck brand, or what's it called? What's your little cigars called?
The camping ones that I use, yeah. The Backwoods.
Backwoods, yes. Kevin and Sarah.
Yeah, because they're a nice, easy smoke. They go down easy. They're not expensive. You get like six in a pack. And as far as I know, there's like three different packs in terms of flavor wise.
Yeah, well, Kevin and Sarah brought back like a huge bag of them. They went, they got every flavor. Yeah, it was great. So we did that. It wasn't a crazy late night because we knew we had to get up early the next day. Put Sean downstairs on the pullout. Got an air mattress for Jeff. Put him downstairs too. Josh Creep, he stayed up in the living room. He brought his own, like a little single air mattress. And I was upstairs in the bedroom kind of laughing to myself because I could hear him blowing it up himself using his mouth. It's long breaths. This poor bastard having to blow up this air mattress at this guy's house. He could have slept on the couch, but he chose not to. Next day, we had to be up super early because I wanted to be at the venue for like sometime before 9 because my oldest daughter had a volleyball thing at the school beside the venue for the Barrie Game Exchange at 9 o'clock. What awesome luck that both of these events happen right beside each other so we wouldn't have to be driving around town. So we had to be, I think I told you what, we're leaving. We want to be out of the driveway at 7:30. And you said, I'll be there at 7. And then we all.
Yeah, I got up. Time did I get up at? About 5. Showered. And then I had to hit up the STC storage locker. Because I hadn't packed anything yet.
Hadn't packed.
So that took me about 20 minutes. But the storage locker is off-site. So it's on the way to your place. So it wasn't much of a misdirection or out of my way. Just ended up probably using, like I said, probably about another 15 minutes just to pack everything up. And then I just went straight up the highway. It was an easy drive that early in the morning. It's nice and peaceful. I did my usual listening to the community podcasts like I do every time I come up for the show. And it's a nice, easy drive. And then when I'm about 10 minutes away from your house, I said, where are you? We're pacing the driveway. And I texted back saying, I'm just getting off the highway. And I was there within 5 minutes. And then we still had to wait for J-Rock to show up. So there was no need for me to rush. He showed up 5 minutes later.
Well, he was on time. We just all expedited ourselves knowing you'd be there at 7. But it was
great for immediately as soon as I got out of the car, I went and gave Sean a big hug because I hadn't seen him in years. A couple of years. 3 years, I think, now.
Yep.
Yeah, since everybody came here for the Barrie Game Exchange from the States and all over Canada. So that was great to see him. He looked to be doing really good and good spirits. Gave everyone else a hug, and J-Rock popped out from a bush. We all got into vehicles. We went for our breakfast, which is at the same haunt that we hit up last time, which was some pancake hut, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is what it's called?
Jack's Pancake Factory.
And it was extra delicious breakfast. And a big thank you to Kevin for paying for everybody.
Oh, my God. That was amazing.
He balled it out, man.
Yeah.
He whipped out his cock and threw it on the table and said, you guys try and top this. Boom. I'm paying for everybody. I nearly fell out of my seat. It was ridiculous. I was incredibly, I'm sure when Kevin listens to this, that was incredibly generous of you, Kevin. Thank you very much.
Yeah, that was awesome. That was awesome.
And then we went to the show or the arena, which was about 10 minutes away.
I was a little disappointed at that breakfast, though, because they sat us at two different tables and I didn't get to watch you eat.
What does that mean?
Well, I like to,
I'm
what happens if you taste stuff or not and how you behave. I taste stuff
when there's other people around, I taste stuff.
I don't know.
When it's you, there's no point.
Mm-hmm.
So we went to the arena, which was at the north end of Barrie. Not close like the last one was. But nonetheless, we showed up. We all parked out the doors. You used the dolly and forced me to carry all my stuff in. So I'm glad I contributed to half of that dolly.
Actually, you never did end up paying for the dolly, but you could have used it.
When?
I don't know what you were doing.
When you were all done using it?
You went crazy and started he-manning your stuff.
Yeah, because I wasn't going to wait 15 minutes for you to pull all your stuff out.
No, that's not. No, I think you saw another muscle guy there, and there was two other ones.
No one was offering to help, so I'm like, fuck it. Fuck all you guys. I'm going to do it myself. So that's it, man. Just muscled it in.
Did you get in there first? Like, were you the one who, like, situated everyone at the tables?
I grabbed those two tables.
Oh, yeah, because I get there, and magically, I am at the first table beside the entrance. Like, whoa, this is something new. This will be crazy. So that was exciting. And we had a red tablecloths for all Cartridge Club, for five Cartridge Club tables paid for by the Cartridge Club, these tablecloths. And so we had red tablecloths, and then behind us we had Cartridge Club posters down the lane. So visually impactful, I thought. You could definitely tell we were all together, and it was about something. So that was cool.
It didn't seem like there was as many tables at this show compared to the last one, but I don't know if that was just my perception of it. It didn't seem crowded. Like, even
there's lots of room.
Even the two times I did a lap around, I wasn't being jostled. There's plenty of space in the aisleways. So it was nice. It wasn't like, you know, when you go to some of those cramped shows and, you know, everyone's elbow to elbow jostling. It's good. The stink factor wasn't as high as it normally is.
No, there was some waves of something going on, but it would pass. I think that might be our oldest arena in town. So it's solid structure, built to maintain a proper climate, like super high roof. So all the heat just goes up there. It doesn't stay down by us where the ice would be. So it stayed cool.
Maybe that's what it was.
Mm-hmm. I didn't get out from the table very often. I wasn't given that opportunity by my partner.
Yeah, you got out more than I did. Went down and started talking to people.
Yes, I said hello.
I wasn't given the opportunity. we're busy. I'm like, what?
Well, yeah, there was the one time you wanted to bail, we had 20 people in front of our table. I want to go.
There was not 20 people.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And I said, Sean, can you just watch here for like 5 minutes? I'll be right back, man.
Oh, my gosh.
And he was like, of course. For you, anything.
He was in his glory, man. He was in his glory. Got to chat with everyone, came up, made the sales pitch. The first people that came up when he was watching your stuff for you was Navy guys. Like, they're wearing Navy hats and jackets that had their ship and stuff embroidered onto it. So he started, were you on this? And it turned out he sailed with that guy. The two of them sailed the same ship together, you know, East Canada at some point, and they both end up together at this Barrie Game Exchange meeting, which was pretty cool. And that guy bought, you know, a medium expensive game from you. It was a $25 game. He didn't even dicker. He goes, okay, here's 20 and here's 5. And Sean gives him back the 5. He's like, nah, we're old shipmates. You're not paying full price.
Oh, I didn't know that.
My jaw dropped. I'm like, he gave you the 25. There's one thing to say beforehand, just give me 20. He literally put the money in Sean's hand and Sean gave it back to him. one of the top moments of the day, right?
Every time he's with me at a show, he costs me money. Both times, I should say. That guy costing me money.
Proper gentleman. It was a great moment. Great moment to witness. Thank God it was one of your titles.
Add it to the tab.
So we kind of split the strategy of our table offerings this year. I managed like a hardware section and you managed a software section.
Yeah, I think that worked out pretty good.
You were happy with it?
No, because you hogged all the hardware section.
And you hogged all the software section. What does that mean?
No, I didn't. What are you talking about?
I don't know what you're saying. We split the duties.
You threw all your shit at the front.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you mean hey, my man. Hardware.
I go, that's hey, man, can I have this little corner here, please, you think?
No, that's not true, folks. That's not true. Let literally me tell you. Who sold a Wii? Joe sold a Wii because Joe's shit Wii took real estate on that table. Who sold a 360? Joe. And that shit 360 took up real estate on the table. Who stole a GameCube? Joe. That took up real estate on the table. So don't you tell me, mister. Yeah, now, I know my software.
All my stuff was behind yours.
No. My software got put underneath yours. So that was something.
What are you talking about?
Yeah. What am I talking
about? How could it get put under yours when yours is at the front row? Yeah,
that could be how it didn't sell. Mine was at the front? Not at the front. Oh, Jesus.
It's right on the edge of the table at the front.
And like, I think
that's how we're going to play. All right.
Now, we worked well together. It did get dicey when people would like want to buy multiple items from the two of us and then discount it out. And then we'd be like, you know, it's not, you know, how do we discount it? Though we did get an early rape job from a vendor that is notorious for going around before the doors open and buying, like fully buying out people. He literally, at this show, bought out two whole tables before the game show even opened. Did you know about that?
Seriously?
Yeah. Haji is like walking by and went, why is there two unsold tables here? They weren't. This guy had bought those tables entirely before the show opened. And so he goes up and down the aisles and he makes piles on people's tables if they are willing to deal with them. And he came to ours and he built a couple big stacks. And I've always said before, I hate selling to dealers before the general public gets there because I'm there to sell to the public, not to this asshole dealers. However, due to me having not such a good return last show, I was willing to take money from whatever. And he wanted to give out some money. So he made a huge stack.
It was fine.
He made a huge stack and then he wanted to discount it all. And we're like, well, we can't. It's both of ours. So we're going to have to separate and then make separate deals. Which we did. He got a heavily discounted, but we got a big pile of money to start the show. So I was happy. Even though he got discount stuff, but yeah, it's better to get that money right away than like I had a lot at by the end of the show, there was a lot of titles that I was shocked didn't sell. So I would have hated to gone through that whole show and not sold that stuff. You were fine.
It was a good event.
You were fine with him with pre-selling to that guy?
I don't care. I just wanted to get rid of stuff.
Yeah, exactly. And we sold a bunch of hardware to another dealer. One dealer took, I think, three N64s from us.
I don't know. You did that one.
Yeah.
I don't recognize who's dealers and who's not dealers.
Oh, you do. Really. Yes, you do.
I don't. I don't pay that much attention.
Oh, you didn't know who Pretty Boys were?
I know who the pretty brothers are, yes.
Yeah.
Well, actually, one's better looking than the other. It's a little bit of twins action going on there. You know what I mean?
And they got steep discounts on that hardware, but I was in the mindset of, I just got to get that money in, and it's better to get the money in than take that sucker home. And, It was awesome, man. My table would it was rammed, and then there'd be these holes in the table. So I got to put more stuff out.
What did the 64s end up selling for? The ones from Pittsburgh.
They sold for 45 each, so 90 altogether. But me and Haji both had to put in assets into the package. I put in two controllers and he put in two AV packs. So we were down another $40 off the top. So we didn't really make a lot of money off those. Split that up between those of us invested in it. We each get $12.50 back.
You gave me $12?
No, I owe you that.
Oh. Woo.
Yeah. And Haji, since there's he put in $20, breakfast. He gets 20 plus the 12. So we didn't make a killing hauling those back, but it's all gravy because we already got what we wanted out of that package anyways. Right? We're happy. And
how
I didn't
did
want
to sell for so less.
Well, the opening hour, they didn't sell.
They just bought two.
No, we had four to sell, right?
Yeah, and no, those, opening. No, I mean the ones from the Pittsburgh thing. There's only two of them, right?
Yeah, we only had two, but we had two more to sell, or I had two more to sell on top of that. So they just weren't moving until that guy. Well, I sold one to a private person, and he got a screaming deal too because it had an expansion pack, and he got the whole system with a controller for $55. And then Pretty Boy came and wanted to buy any else that we had. So I went, yeah, please, just give me money. Give me money. Take it. I was just so scared of taking this stuff back home, which at the end of the day, I ended up taking home two Super Nintendos that didn't sell. I'm shocked beyond belief that a Super Nintendo won't sell. Complete packages. Huh? Super Nintendos. GameCubes sold like crazy. People asking, any more GameCubes? I'll buy them. N64s ended up selling. We sold two 360s. Who'd have thought? An old style 360s, the ones you would stay away from. I sold a PlayStation 3 Fat, one that you should generally stay away from. We sold a Wii. I was hoping to sell three more, but we didn't. Just Joe sold. But you practically gave it away. It was a huge package with Wii and three controllers, three nunchucks, AV power, the works.
Two controllers, two nunchucks.
Okay, two. And you had $25 on it. These two dudes come up. Yeah, it's all that for $25? And Joe's negotiation tactic is to immediately open with a lesser price than what you see. So they didn't even have a chance to think about $25. Joe's like, duh. 20, you take it right now. 20. And they're like, $20 for all that? That is so crazy.
That's what it's worth, man. No one gives a shit about the Wii.
And then they walked away.
Yeah.
Like, what?
It's like, take it, guys.
What the hell?
It's a piece of garbage. I'll give you 20 to take it.
They went so crazy over it.
Because nobody wants a Wii.
I think those are the guys that came back, though, to get it, right?
I don't know. I'll pay attention.
So I was really shocked to see those mid-era consoles going because I didn't think anyone would want those anymore. But there it is. But we were priced to sell. 360, $30. Take it. Get out of here. And it happened. Sold stuffies. I was glad to see, you know, it was surprising the amount of stuff that was sold. When we were packing up at the end of the day, it's like I'm missing boxes or something. There's got to be more for me to take back to my car than this. It was at that moment I knew that had been a successful show because I had barely anything to take back to the car. Did you get the same? You were packing up an hour before the show ended, which got me angry. So you had more time to examine how much you were packing up. Did you have the same feeling at the end?
Well, I went home lighter than I went there with, so I can't really complain too much about it, I guess. Still got a bunch of garbage. I need to get rid of. So it was a pretty good show. I think we were both happy with it. I think the best part was that we got to see a bunch of people again that we hadn't seen for a while. It's always nice to see Miles and Catherine. They showed up at the last half hour. I wish they had organized their ride up a bit better.
I think they were organized. They were in the victim of bad luck, right?
You didn't. Well, that's what I mean. Like, they missed their bus, right?
No. The bus broke down.
Oh, I heard they missed it.
It was like Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. They're having to wait for another bus to come pick them up. Ugh. And then do all this crap. Because on the weekend, the train only takes you up so far, and then you got to switch over to a bus, which they did. And then that bus breaks down. It's just a comedy of errors for them getting up here. Finally, they made it.
Will had told them he would have picked them up if they had made it up to the 401 in Pickering.
Yeah, next time, that's all they got to do, right? Head over there.
They can drive up with the Beamer.
Yeah, but they don't stay very long, so.
But maybe they should change. Stay a while.
What happened? So J-Rox stuck around for the whole show.
Yep.
We also saw Rhino Vision there. He's vending. Saw Troy there. Troy came up. Yeah. Troy and his fam. And then, of course, at the end, we stayed to help out, break down the venue, put all the tables away. Except for that one vendor who refuses to take his stuff off the tables. This one, he gets five tables, and even though all the tables were broken down,
it was him and another vendor. There's at least 10 tables that were completely, they were still fully stocked. Nothing was taken off of them. So I said, forget it. I'm not dealing with these guys.
Yeah. So we're all just standing around waiting, and they're just, I don't know, going over their inventory, I guess. Which is not the... Hodge told me they ended up just, like, the organizers just took their stuff and put it on the floor to break down the tables, which is probably a great idea we should do next time.
Yep.
Guys, you're kicked out. Time is up, unless you want to pay for the arena. So, of course, it's not another CC tradition to go to the buffet afterwards. And we're all piling into cars to go to Uncle Bob's buffet. Joe had to leave, so he couldn't make it. Kevin and Sarah jump in their car, go to Uncle Bob's. The parking lot's empty, even though it's a Sunday, and a sign on the door. Uncle Bob's is closed. Closed. Closed on a Sunday? How's that possible? Turns out, by checking on the Google... Or maybe it was on the sign, too. They closed permanently. They just up and closed September 1st. No more Uncle Bob's buffet. So I thought that was insane. But we do have another option. There is another buffet at the other end of town, which by luck is nearer to my house. And that's called the Market Buffet. Same idea as Uncle Bob's, but it was never as good. So we took the whole troop there. Everyone went there for the chow. And something happened. The Market Buffet has upped their game because it was a spectacular feat. Everyone was very happy with the selection and the food quality there. So it was all good. Everything worked out. It was a little bit more expensive than Uncle Bob's. And they nickeled and dimed us on the soft drinks. That's what I liked about Uncle Bob's. All the drinks, coffees, all that's out on the buffet. This time you had to pre-purchase your drinks, which is... That just sticks in my craw just a little bit. However, we had a big old feed, got out of there, went back to my house again, had some more CC cigars. Then the party broke up. That's all she wrote. Everyone went on their way. The next day, Sean and Jeff, they slept in, by the way, on Monday. Well, Sean, morning guy, slept in past 9. So we kept him up. Yeah, he still got his sleep in. I had the kids off to school. He hadn't been up yet. He says he's a morning guy. You remind him of that day where he slept in, if he says that to you. And then they went away to their plane later that day. And that was it. Left on my own on the Monday. However, I'll have more company coming tomorrow. So the house is reset and again ready for more company.
All right, good recap of the show. Hope everyone enjoyed that. Anything else you want to finish off with?
A big thank you to Nintendo Hodge and the other organizers of the Barrie Game Exchange. Another fabulous, successful event. Sure, the venue was farther away from my house, but it seemed to be the perfect venue. And they did a good job selecting it, good time to do it. Everyone seemed very happy by it. The Cartridge Club is very appreciative to what the Barrie Game Exchange could do for them. And we hope to move forward into the future. If you would like to tell us your stories from the day or what you thought of this episode, go over to thecartridgeclub.org. Look for our podcast, STCPod, and there should be a thread there. Thanks to James, who started last week's thread. And hopefully this thread will be there too, and you can add comments there, cartridgeclub.org. You can follow me on Twitter at STCPod and Joe at AC Decepticon.
And go to my YouTube, My Life in Collecting, because I just posted a video of walkthrough footage of the show, if you guys want to check it out. Go there and see the latest video at My Life in Collecting on YouTube.
Yeah. The start to continue, folks, we're there, but the video is on My Life in Collecting. On the Start to Continue YouTube channel, Start to Continue, you'll see a little preview. I did a little 2-minute video on there. You'll get to see of what our tables look like. And I had, that's on the Start to Continue our channel together. And I hope you check out a new video that I put up this week. The latest of the Third Man Records vault release came out, a special side project from Jack White. Had a cool album and a bunch of books came in the mail. Check that out.
All right. Thanks, everybody. Catch you again on the flip side.
Post and post it.